بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise and thanks belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And may the peace and blessing of Allah be upon His servant and final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. First of all, my brothers in Islam, and we're going to start with just a short word of advice about yesterday's event, the eclipse. And more importantly, what lessons does a Muslim learn from the eclipse? What lessons should we come out of yesterday, and what lessons are we supposed to learn from that? If you were to observe, and those who prayed Salat al-Kusuf yesterday morning, and we ask, how long did the prayer take? How long did the Salat take roughly? Those who prayed Salat al-Kusuf yesterday?
1 hour.
About 1 hour. See that 1 hour? That should be your daily routine before Salat al-Fajr every single day. That should be your daily routine during the night somewhere, every single day. The one who has this as a routine found yesterday's salat, he was able to connect with yesterday's salat and not feel it a burden or a pressure upon him, because he's used to this. And this is how Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches us to prepare for the hereafter. Well, yesterday morning, that salat, people came and they were praying it. Some were praying it with the intention that this could be possibly the last salat and the last ayat they hear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's word before the hereafter begins. Possibly it could have been that. Some people prayed yesterday with the intention that, salat is something beautiful, inshallah he's recharging his iman, no problems. And some had no idea why they were praying yesterday. And certain people came yesterday and they prayed with us after Salat al-Fajr and asked, what was that we just prayed? Alhamdulillah, it's all good. This is his moment and his opportunity to learn. So inshallah, next time he comes ready. But with these intentions, the highest of them was the one who prayed yesterday with the intention that these ayat he's hearing and this salat he's praying could possibly be the last salat and the last ayat he'll hear before the day of judgment begins. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, he says, "Inna sa'ata la'atiyah, wa inna sa'ata atiyatun akadu ukhfiha." That the hour is coming, wal mizan is coming, wal sirat is coming, and the paradise and the hereafter is about to come. This is all reality, it's coming. Allahu a'lam how close it is. For Allah Azza wa Jalla, he said, akadu ukhfiha. I almost keep it hidden. I've almost kept the hour hidden. What does that mean? In other words, I'll show you signs. I'll send some signs so you can see that the hour is on the way. What happened yesterday is no doubt one of the signs of the day of judgment, where subhanallah, akadu ukhfiha litujza kullu nafsin bima tas'a. Now my brothers in Islam, the calculation, it tells us that the eclipse, it starts on this time and it'll end on this time. Yesterday they got it right, but one day the calculation is going to get it wrong. The eclipse will start, and then at the end of it would actually be the start of the day of judgment. As the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions, Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the Quran, فَإِذَا بَرِقَ الْبَصَرُ وَخَسَفَ الْقَمَرُ وَجُمِعَ الشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرُ. When Allah Azza wa Jalla described the day of judgment, He described in the Quran major events that will occur on the last day on earth. And He said on the last day on earth, بَرِقَ الْبَصَرُ. بَرِقَ يعني حَارَ الْبَصَرُ. The eyesight of the people becomes confused. So it looks left and it looks right, and all signs are happening around that the stars are falling, the moon is falling, and so on. If everyone is looking around to see what kind of chaos is happening around them. فَإِذَا بَرِقَ الْبَصَرُ. The other major event that happens on the last day, وَخَسَفَ الْقَمَرُ. When the moon is eclipsed, وَجُمِعَ الشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرُ. The moon being eclipsed, meaning the light of the moon disappears. This is what happens in an eclipse. The light of the moon disappears. وَجُمِعَ الشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرُ. And the sun and the moon both will be joined together. They will crash and collide with each other. As a result, they will lose their light. So, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is why he got scared when he saw the eclipse. And this is why he became terrified. Because the eclipse is one of the major events that happened on the last day of this earth. That is a major event. So in the lifetime of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the light of the sun disappeared, he became scared and terrified, because he didn't know if the light of the sun will be regained once again or not, if it'll light up once again or not. If it doesn't, then that means, khalas, that's it. He's the day of judgment, it'll occur. For he got scared, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you know, the day of judgment, yani how does it occur? Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says in the Quran, هَلْ يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَّا السَّاعَةَ أَن تَأْتِيَهُمْ بَغْتَةً وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. When Allah Azza wa Jalla described the coming of the hour, he described it with the word بَغْتَةً وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. That it comes بَغْتَة, all of a sudden. وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ, and you have no idea and you did not even feel about it. Wallah, when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith, when he describes the day of judgment and how it unfolds, he mentions that at the end of time, just before the day of judgment strikes on the disbelievers, there is a man who's yani basically walking his camels to where they're going to eat, where they're going to drink. He's walking his camels there. Yani it's a normal day for people. People are on their daily business. And he is the first one who hears nafkhatu sur. He is the first one who hears the blow of breath in the trumpet. And as a result, he turns left and right and the people begin to drop from the sound that they hear, right? Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَيَوْمَ يُنْفَخُ فِي الصُّورِ فَصَعِقَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ, meaning they begin to fall one after the other, dying from this sound that they hear. فَيَعْنِي, this is how the hour has been described, بَغْتَةً. All of a sudden, people are on their daily business and it just occurs. So, يعني, if it was going to be the day of judgment, if it was going to be the day of judgment on the day of eclipse, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted to be prepared. Because if this is going to be the last moments on earth, then I wanted to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while I am standing before His hand in salat. This is why he rushes to as-salat and he makes, يعني Bilal radiallahu anhu, make the call, as-salatu jami'ah, as-salatu jami'ah. He says this a few times until the people came and gathered. As-salatu jami'ah, meaning we're going to pray in congregation. We're going to pray in congregation. And then the people came together and they began to pray as-salat. Well, subhanAllah, you find something incredible. That during the eclipse, after the salat, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave a khutbah. And he encouraged the people to do almost all kinds of good deeds you can think of. Yani included in Rasulullah's speech and his khutbah, he encouraged the people, first and foremost, to believe that this is a sign from Allah Azza wa Jalla. For believing it's a sign and being certain about that is a reason for why the iman increases, right? Number two, as-salat. Number three, he encouraged the people to make dua. Then he encouraged in another hadith, at-takbir. People to go around and say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Then he encouraged the people, as-sadaqah, tasaddaqu, keep on giving sadaqah until it's removed, until it goes away. Then he encouraged the people, al-istighfar, to continuously make istighfar. And he encouraged in another hadith, idqu al-raqaba, to free a slave, go around and look for a slave and free him. And he encouraged also to seek refuge from the punishment of the grave. Ta'awwadhu min adhab al-qabr. All of these kinds of worship, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching us that we're supposed to engage in and do during the eclipse. Why? Then the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us that the eclipse could be the last moments on earth. Winter, you're supposed to be prepared, find yourself in a worship. Yani if these were the last days on earth and you're resurrected on the day of judgment before Allah Azza wa Jal, make the last thing that you did on earth some kind of good deed, whatever it is. Look how many opportunity you have. Do anything as long as be engaged in a hasana. For Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching us that the way you're supposed to prepare for the hereafter is with good deeds. That's the way you're supposed to prepare. What kind of good deeds? All these that he mentioned, almost everything of al-Islam, of the good deeds that we know of. Right? When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once, a man comes to him and he says to him, Mata as-sa'a? When is the hour going to happen? Shuf, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't say to him, Allahu a'lam. He responded to him and he said to him, وَمَاذَا أَعْدَدْتَ لَهَا? What did you prepare for it? Why are you asking this question? What preparation have you made for that day? Are you ready for that day to be tomorrow so that you're resurrected and standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? For this is the idea. What kind of preparation have you made? The hour, the hereafter. We don't need the knowledge of what it is. And for every single person, you need the knowledge of what have you prepared for that day? Have you prepared enough to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This must be the question. This is what you're supposed to reflect on like yesterday morning. This is the thing that you were supposed to reflect on yesterday morning. And keep this kind of idea and this question in your mind until you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What have you prepared for that day? My brothers in Islam, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was praying Salat al-Kusuf, He saw the paradise. In the hadith, قُرِّبَتْ إِلَيْهِ, the paradise was brought near to him. This we learn from this, that يعني, the paradise, it comes towards الصالحين. And the righteous good deeds that lead to the paradise also comes towards الصالحين. Allah Azza wa Jal, يعني, he says about the day of judgment, وَأُزْلِفَتِ الْجَنَّةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ غَيْرَ بَعِيدٍ, that on the day of judgment, the paradise itself, Allah brings it forward to the believers. Uzlifat meaning it comes forward out of honor. Doesn't mean we deserved it, but it was Allah Azza wa Jal's honor towards the believer of the good that he did in this life, that he brings the paradise close to him. Fanta, if you want the paradise to come close to you, in this life you're supposed to come close to it, and you're supposed to come close to it with the good deeds that you do. As a result, on the day of judgment, Allah Azza wa Jal honors the believers by bringing the paradise close. When the paradise was brought close to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam during his salat, we're learning that the most thing that will bring the paradise close to you is as-salat. Then when he was praying, it came close to him. In other words, yani, one of the greatest means of bringing yourself closer to the paradise is through as-salat itself. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam in his salat, he saw the hellfire as well. And when he saw it, he stepped back. He's the one who stepped back. Yani, shufa, paradise came to him. And when the hellfire was there, he began to step back away from it. Yani, min lahibiha, from the heat, from the intense flame that was coming out of it. Him stepping back sallallahu alayhi wasallam teaches us that if he made effort to stay away from the hellfire, then yani, we're always supposed to make the effort to keep away from the hellfire and to keep away from the actions that lead to the hellfire, especially during these months, al-ashhur al-hurum. These are the sacred months. We are now in Dhul-Qa'dah, and then after it, Dhul-Hijjah, and then Muharram. We've just started this, يعني, the 3 months of ashhur al-hurum, and then there's one more that comes afterwards. يعني, these months of al-ashhur al-hurum, the sacred months, where you're not supposed to commit, يعني, or you're supposed to stay from the sins away from the sins as best as you can during the year. But especially during these months, لأن الله عز وجل, he says in the Quran, فَلَا تَظْلِمُوا فِيهِنَّ أَنفُسَكُمْ, do not wrong yourselves in these months. Don't do the wrong in these months. They're great in this month. فيعني, أنت, you need to learn that yesterday صلاة الكسوف was during الأشهر الحرم. How much, يعني, how much emphasis does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala place upon a person, يعني, to keep away from the sins as best as he can. Now, when the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he saw the hellfire and he stepped back, he said that he saw three kinds of punishments. Number one, he saw Amr ibn Malik yajurru qasbahu fi nari jahannam. He saw Amr ibn Malik. Amr ibn Malik is actually the first person who brought a shirk into Mecca. He brought a shirk into Mecca. He was in Bisham somewhere, and he saw them worshipping idols, and he got interested. He said to them, what's this? They said to him, Allah, this is an idol we pray to and we worship when we want rain, and rain comes down. So it was a fitna for him. He grabbed it and he put it on a camel. So you have a sawa'ib, right? So he put it on a camel, and he brought the camel into Mecca, and he placed it right next to the Kaaba, and he told the people what it is, and people began to worship it. So he was the first one to bring a shirk into Mecca. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw him in the fire, dragging his intestines behind. Yani, in other words, internal punishment. His intestines are out and they're dragging behind him, and this is his punishment in Jahannam. This is what he saw. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, during his salat as well, salat al-kusuf, he saw yani, the person stealing the hujjaj. There was a person that was stealing the wolf of the hujjaj and so on. He saw him as well in Jahannam. يَجُرُّ قَصَبَهُ فِي جَهَنَّمْ. He's dragging his intestines around with him in Jahannam. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he saw a woman in the hellfire burning. And the reason why she's burning is because she owned a cat in this life. A cat. And she tied the cat. She did not feed the cat, nor did she allow it to go and eat from the grass and so on, and whatever it can find to eat. For in other words, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches us three things, and these are three categories. The first one, which is Amr ibn Malik, this is a crime against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It represents da'iyatu su', the da'i that calls to misguidance and misguides the people. And on the day of judgment, Jahannam is the first station that he stops at. The first one is the crime against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second category, the person that stole the hujjaj, is the person that committed the crimes against mankind. And the third, is the one who committed the crime against the animals. For Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching us that the crime against Allah and the crime against the people and the crime against the animal, all these are actions of Jahannam. They all lead to Jahannam, wal-iyadhu billah. فيعني, this is why you're supposed to learn that these are just, يعني, these are categories of bigger things. Not just the idea, no, I haven't done the first one, I didn't do the second one, I didn't do the third one, I'm all good. And to see, يعني, the sin, where is it? Is it against Allah? Keep away from it, because that leads to Jahannam. Is your sin against the people? Keep away from it, because that leads to Jahannam. Is your sin against animals? Even if that's the case, then you're supposed to keep away from it, because that is something that eventually ends the person into Jahannam. Wal-iyadhu billah. And the last point I make on this reflections of what we're supposed to learn from the eclipse, the event yesterday, was that if you reflect into the lifetime of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is a very important point, this one. You find that the greatest moment in the lifetime of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in where he cried, yani the greatest moment in where he cried heavily and intensely, was when the last few ayat of Surah Al-An'am were revealed to him, of Surah Al-Imran were revealed to him. This was by far the greatest moment in the lifetime of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in where he cried so heavily. His beard soaked with his tears, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The area on the floor in where he makes a sujood and where his foot was soaked with his tears, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To the point when he came out and Bilal radiallahu anhu saw him, he said to him, I have never seen you cry as much as I've seen you today. And he was in his house. And he said to him, Ya Bilal, unzilat alayya al-laylata ayat, waylun liman qara'aha wa lam yatadabbarha. That was the scene. He said to him, O Bilal, ayat were revealed to me this night, which were inna fi khalq as-samawati wal-ardi wa ikhtilafi al-layli wal-nahari la-ayatin li-uli al-albab alladhina yadhkuruna Allah. Up until the end of these ayat, the last ayat of Surah Al-Imran, he said to him, Allah has revealed to me ayat this night. Waylun, may the destruction befall the one who reads them, walam yatadabbarha, and does not ponder over them, does not contemplate over them. Yani to be saved from the punishment of Allah and the destruction of Allah, it's not enough to read them, you're supposed to also ponder over them. Shuf, anta subhanallah, measure yourself with this hadith, where you're supposed to be and where you are right now, and work towards where you're supposed to be. These are ayat that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam cried because of. Read their tafsir and understand them and keep them in your heart and keep them in your mind. Now, why I'm mentioning this? Because al-ulama rahimahumullah also mentioned what was the second greatest event in the lifetime of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam where he cried heavily. So this was the first moment. The second time he cried intensely was during al-kusuf that happened on his time. And it was only recorded one kusuf in the lifetime of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it was when the sun was eclipsed. There is no record that the moon eclipsed during the lifetime of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The only eclipse they witnessed and they prayed was salat al-kusuf, meaning when the sun was eclipsed. So in other words, it was there and all of a sudden the light of the sun disappeared and it was dark time. Yani, very terrifying and a scary event. But let's understand this. When the sun eclipsed during his lifetime, on that day, earlier that day, something happened. What happened earlier that day? Does anyone know what happened earlier that day before the sun eclipsed? His son Ibrahim radiallahu anhu died. Okay, when his son radiallahu anhu Ibrahim, when he died, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, what did he say? He said words, three statements. He said, inna al-ayna la tadma wa inna al-qalba la yahzan wa inna ala firaqika ya Ibrahim la mahzunun. He said, verily, he looked at his son as he's laying there motionless, dead. He said, inna al-ayn, verily the eye, it tears. You might have read these narrations. Verily the eye tears. وَالْقَلْبَ لَا يَحْزَنْ. And the heart finds grief and sadness. وَإِنَّ عَلَى فِرَاقِكَ يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ لَمَحْزُونُونَ. And because of your departure, O Ibrahim, you've departed this life, we are really upset and we're sad, right? But يعني, we say, Alhamdulillah. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, إِنَّ الْعَيْنَ لَتَدْمَعَ. The eye tears. This was when? Just before the eclipse, a few hours before the eclipse. And then later that day, when the sun eclipsed, and yani, he feared for this ummah that Allah Azza wa Jal's punishment would come down on them, Al-Hadith describes him, baka buka'an shadida. He cried intensely and he cried heavily. And in his crying, his sujood, he began to blow breath. Yani oof, oof, like this, as the Hadith mentions. So in other words, you realize something in this Hadith. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as he's in his sujood, he's blowing breath, al-ulama, they say, on the fire that he saw. And he's crying for this ummah that perhaps the punishment might come down. And then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in his sujood, Rabbi alam ta'idni an la tu'adhibahum wa ana feehim. Alam ta'idni an la tu'adhibahum wa hum yastaghfirun. He says, oh Allah, didn't you promise me that you will not punish me as long as I'm among them and I'm alive with them? And didn't you also promise me that you will not punish them? You will not send down the hereafter if I'm not here and they are making istighfar? So when he made this dua and he said that, فَزِعَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ فَرَغَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مِنْ صَلَاتِهِ وَقَدْ أَمْحَضَتِ الشَّمْسِ. He got up from his salat and the light of the sun began to regain and the eclipse went. يعني عذاب الله سبحانه وتعالى went. So in other words, you learn something here. That when his son رضي الله عنه died and he was still fresh and warm in his grave, and Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم only teed. But when the eclipse happened a few hours that day, he began to cry heavily. In other words, his concern for the ummah and concern for them being punished was much greater and more intense on his heart than the death of his own son, which happened the same day. فيعني what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching us, that we're supposed to have the same concern for the affairs of this ummah. يعني it doesn't only make sense that you sit here, alhamdulillah, and I'm among my little circle, and goodbye, I don't want to know anyone outside and what is happening with people outside. You don't have a choice to make that. The fact that you become a Muslim, you've signed up to an entire ummah that you're supposed to feel its affairs. For Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he cries, he's teaching us, my concern for this ummah book is greater than my own personal worries I have and my own little things I have. Even if it was my son to die, yes, even if it was my son to die, it's not as big as the concern he had for the ummah. For we have to learn, my brothers in Islam, yani al concern of the ummah, always keep it at heart. This is what we learn from Salat al-Kusuf, the event yesterday. This is what it teaches us, to always have the ummah in our concerns, in our worries, right? Remember them always with a dua, with a sadaqah that you make, with a good word that you speak, something that alleviates its affairs in your own capacity, whatever you can help with, help. You're always supposed to be there in your mind, in your conscience, in your concern, right? فيعني this is what we learn from Al-Kusuf. Wallahu a'lam. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.